So we'll start with questions from the advisory committee.
Thanks, Harrison. Yeah, you really did do a fabulous job, both with the paper and really with the presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, I learned a ton. That's good. So you mentioned some of the concerns about genetic editing and the ability to make designer babies and soldiers and things of this nature. So you mentioned that. You also mentioned that some of these technologies have been around for over a decade, close to 20 years in humans, and we haven't seen that with those technologies, but the newer ones you mentioned, like the CRISPR-Cas9 and Talon, those are more powerful, and they're just beginning to be used in humans, so not yet, but pretty soon. From what you've read and in your opinion, do you think these new technologies, do you have the ability to be used by small groups of rogue researchers, or does it still require too much effort to use those technologies in humans?
Great question. I do believe that, unfortunately, CRISPR and new, more effective iterations of genetic editing technologies may result in rogue scientists misusing them. In my paper, I touched on biohackers who are individuals who perform scientific experiments such as gene editing without a professional lab and traditional training. Some of these individuals inject themselves with certain things to try and make them younger or stay alive longer. I saw one that tried to inject something into the bottom of their eye. So there's not much regulation surrounding that, but I definitely do think that new iterations like CRISPR and the new iterations that continue to come out definitely can be used in a bad way.
Wonderful job, Mr. Cormier. I really enjoyed that so much. I have a question for you from Heather, who couldn't be here today. She said, concerns around germline gene editing seem to be most focused on the negative effects arising from its failure. Equally important should be the concerns surrounding its potential success. In a theoretical framework where germline gene editing is successful and implemented clinically, what possible impacts could there be on society when considering justice and equal access?
Well, I agree that most criticism is focused on negative effects. Germline editing, if proven safe, will allow for society to supplement evolution as our biology's primary influence, and it will revolutionize medicine in ways we can only begin to imagine. I believe that germline editing or human germline drives administered en masse could allow for complete eradication of most genetic diseases.
Yeah, it really does seem to be exciting, doesn't it, that we have this kind of potential. I have a question. Thank you so much for teaching us today. I thought your slides and your presentation made it really accessible to us all, so I appreciate that. And I sure have enjoyed working alongside you on this. I've learned so much from reading your paper. I know that you didn't even get to touch on most of the things that you put in your very lengthy paper. What to you was the most interesting? What did you really sort of grab onto?
The most interesting thing for me was sort of generally how many applications gene editing has. Mm-hmm. I mean, curing cancer and most diseases to glow-in-the-dark cats and saving files in the DNA. It's just such a wide spectrum of applications, and I think there's so many different things that could come up from further exploring that.
Yeah, I appreciate you slipped the video in there to make us all wake up. And one last question, you touched on quite a bit about GMOs. Why do you think people are so scared? Like I know I think Europe, GMO foods are banned, and we
There's
all
like
see those.
Five of them that they approved.
So why do you think that is when scientists, Nobel Prize winners are saying that we need to embrace GMOs?
I think it's just because there's big companies that are in the agricultural business. And once one of them does something wrong, and suddenly the whole industry's doing things wrong, and people believe that the technologies are being misused left and right, people are getting all sorts of information that's wrong. So I think fake news, really and truly, is probably one of the main reasons people are scared of GMOs and Facebook.
Mr. Cormier, well done. This is sort of stemming from Pam's question. So you've made a case for GMO and for vaccinations. There is this big anti-science movement. What will you do to change that trend?
hopefully tell people what's right, because that's really all you can do. Tell people what's right and tell people what they're doing wrong.
Good job, Mr. Cormier. I was wondering that if, do you think with enough research and technology, if like in a few years' time, if gene editing can bring people back from the dead, possibly?
Unfortunately not, because once you're dead, after a while, your DNA is unusable. That's probably more cloning or something like that.
Good, great job, Mr. Cormier. Why did you choose this exact topic for your master?
Like I told Pam, probably because of the wide variety of things it covers and cures.
Mr. Cormier, do you think that gene editing is morally acceptable?
Good question. I think it really depends on the context. So maybe editing your babies to be better than other people's children isn't morally acceptable in today's society, but GMOs, vaccines, and other forms of gene therapy are definitely acceptable.
You discussed improving people's like cognitive abilities. Would that, in your opinion, would that cause people to maybe rule out certain different learning styles like ADHD or like learning disabilities or dyslexia? And do you think that would negatively or positively help the society?
Good question. I don't remember if I think I might have touched on it in my presentation, but a lot of the people in the world that are more influential have certain problems like ADHD and dyslexia, so I definitely don't think those should be completely eradicated. I don't think society should move to eradicate those before they have a way to find a proper balance.
Excellent job, Mr. Cormier. I was just wondering that in the future, do you think that gene editing is capable of doing more bad than good? And if so, why should we bother?
I think it depends whose hands it's in. I mean, Vladimir Putin gave a speech on super soldiers at the International Children's Festival not that long ago. So I really think, I mean, it depends how he wants to use super soldiers, but if he uses them wrong, then it could be used wrong. If he cures cancer, then it's used right.
Okay, excellent job. My question is kind of like Twyla's. Do you think gene editing can cure or prevent things such as depression or anxiety?
So I actually came across this last week. There was a woman who had certain parts of her DNA just deleted from birth, and she didn't suffer from depression, anxiety, or fear. So scientists, or pain actually, I think, scientists are looking at her DNA to see exactly what makes that happen. And if they knew their way around that whole, her genome, then they could potentially do that in children.
Mr. Cormier, this was a fantastic presentation. It's very detailed. Some of the words you said, I did not understand at all. But something was bugging me as you were talking about this. As a history teacher, there's lots of examples where disease and war and other things have knocked down our population and led to advancements and change and got us where we are today. My question is, if we eradicate cancer, if we eradicate disease, if we eradicate old age, and I think this ties to one of your advisors' question is, aren't we setting ourselves up for disaster?
You mean like eugenics?
No, I mean, as we head into 8 billion people, how can we support a population that doesn't die?
Well, it all sort of works hand in hand, because genetically modified agriculture has, you can feed more people, and then just proper planning means you can house more people, and then it just all sort of would work out with.
There's no end.
There's space.
Good answer.
There was that picture of colonizing Mars, so I think we've got that figured out. I have one quick question before I hand it over to Junior Mr. Cormier. And that was, one of your advisors worked with reproductive, she was a reproductive
counselor
and helping families make decisions about the knowledge of their future children's possible genetic mutations mm-hmm. and diseases that they may have had. So we talked a little bit about this, but how can genetic editing help reproductive freedoms?
Genetic editing could probably help reproductive freedoms because it would allow families with children that might have genetic disease to live more autonomously away from a hospital and have greater well-being because they're not caring for sickly children.
Great job, Mr. Cormier. That was a great presentation, and I'm proud of you.
Thank you.
My question is for you. Which one of those genetically edited animals that you showed on your slide would be best for society?
Economically, at least, probably the salmon, because the salmon is already being used and sold in Canada. In terms of just new ways to do things, maybe the goats, because they let you make improved bulletproof vests and other sort of medical devices, and the pigs really aren't that helpful for society. They just you would get more meat.
So what about fluorescent cats?
Mr. Cormier, I'm frankly staggered by the depth of content in your presentation. You said, oh, it's a basic introduction. Oh, yeah, right, basic introduction. You answered most of my questions through your presentation. Your answers during question period are incredibly intelligent. It's a phenomenal presentation. I learned, you know, this parent-child commodity thing. Okay, that's interesting. And then there's biohackers. I didn't know about them, so I learned all kinds of things. I guess I've got lots of questions. We can talk later, but my one question would be this. In what year will it be the case that we will no longer die?
I don't know. There was some gentleman in Silicon Valley who was trying to inject himself with teenagers and millennials' blood. And apparently he's added a few years onto his life, but he's been shut down by the FDA. So I think until that regulatory mess is cleaned up, then as soon as that's done, then somebody will probably do it.
I'm afraid we are out of time. There are some amazing questions. Thank you for that. And you've answered them very, very well. So we are going to take a short 10-minute break and be back here at 11 o'clock for River Hoopers.